one in 61. It's 5 o'clock and I think we'll start the meeting. First of all, I'd like to take any apologies for absence, and I've had one from Carol Dyer, who is the CEO of Health Rock. She is very happy to be seeing you. Any of us? Anybody else? Thank you very much. Can I also ask all the other members to declare that they have, if they have any interests in the particular item on the agenda? Yes, Councillor Norbury.
It also works for the NHS.
Anybody else? Councillor Gilchrist?
I'm the governor of CWP, and that has some relationship to services.
I work for the NHS, and my son works for the NHS.
Councillor Muspratt?
Daughter works for the NHS.
And I also have a daughter working for the NHS. By way of introduction, first of all, can I say thank you, everybody, for coming along this evening on this very hot evening. We'll do our best to not raise the temperature any higher. I would like to thank all those who are going to make a contribution to the proceedings tonight. By way of background, I think we all know that there was a review of urgent care provision at the end of 2017 that went out for consultation. The consultation was very extensive and very strong response from the public and also from people involved in health and as a result of that consultation, the CCG has revised the plans that they initially brought forward for consultation and produced a different set of plans which were agreed on, I think it was 9th of July at the CCG board, and that's the purpose of the meeting tonight, is to look at those revised plans and from our perspective as a scrutiny committee, look at what the implications are for Wirral. So, we've got a team here from the Wirral CCG, I'll introduce them in a minute. We're going to start with them, we're going to give us a presentation of the revised plans, and then we'll hear from a whole raft of other stakeholders who will give us their views on how these plans might work. So if I could start with the team from the CCG, we've got Nesta Hawker, who's Director of Commissioning and Transformation, Dr. Callum, who's Chair of the CCG, and I know, Dr. Callum, you have to leave quite promptly to go and look after sick people, the day job. Michael Chandler, Senior MTS, right. Zoe Delaney, who's Senior Commissioning Lead in Transformation and Improvement, Chandra Dodgson, who's Head of Service and Programme Management, and Byron Graham, who's Commissioning and Finance Manager. So, would you like to kick off, Dr. Carlson?
Thank you, Councillor, and thank you for inviting us here this evening to go through the decision which was made at the governing body held at the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board on the 9th of July. So, as Councillor McLaughlin says, as Councillor McLaughlin said, we went out to consult, as you all know, at the end of last year. We had a 3-month consultation period around the delivery of urgent care. We had gone out with a set of proposals, and welcome to the feedback which we got in terms of the responses to the surveys which we sent out, but also the petitions which came in from the public. You'll know, and you'll have heard me say here before, that actually I welcome that because I think it demonstrates the depth of interest that our population had in the delivery of health and care, not only from an urgent care point of view, but also the delivery across the board. So we looked at the responses which we had, which came into us. We took an independent view of that in terms of we went out to an external body to review the feedback which came. And that was in order to ensure transparency and to avoid there being any feeling that there was a CCG field put on the responses that we got. And we revised our plans being responsive to what came back to us, and plans were agreed at the governing body. So what we've come today to talk about is just go through the model of care, which was agreed in public on the 9th of July. And you'll see from the slide, which is in front of you, that we have agreed to the 24-hour treatment centre at the Arapark site, the retention of all-age walk-in access for patients, The replacement of two minor injury and illnesses services with same-day access to GP and nurse appointments, and finally addressing a wound care service which can be pre-booked to meet patient demands. The 24-hour urgent treatment centre being placed at the our park site was decided and agreed at governing body in February of 2017. This was based on clinical criteria, of which there are 27 parameters. NHS England have mandated the delivery of urgent care through urgent treatment centres, and of which there are, as I said, a number of parameters, some of which are the ease of access to the emergency department, the ease of access to diagnostics should a patient require that or should they deteriorate. And therefore, the decision based on clinical and quality grounds was to base that on the Hour Park site. However, our plans going forward are not that all of our patients who require urgent care be seen at the urgent treatment centre. Only those with a clinical need should be seen at the urgent treatment centre. And that's why we want to ensure that we have a robust delivery of service within our community and within hubs that are based within the community to ease the journey for our patients, to improve delivery of care, to meet the healthcare needs of our patients and also to meet our constitution standards. So when we look at the consultation feedback, as I said, we went out to consult at the end of last year, and I hope that our response, what we have proposed and what we've come back with demonstrates that we were responsive to the analysis of the public feedback. Public feedback was very, very focused on retention of the OAs in access, which impacted on our consideration and our final object here. And also, during the consultation, we asked our public what was important to them in considering urgent care facilities and where they were based. And we listened to this feedback and used that in what we then went back then what our recommendations were. So the key considerations when you look at what we went out to consult on what had come back were that patients valued and wished to retain all agents to the delivery. And they wanted this to be accessed locally. Crucial to that was the distance from home, the flexibility and convenience of appointments, and also public transport access. There's much transport just in three months. Issues that people, what also came out was the depth of feeling around particular locations in those particular areas where the Brighton Medical Centre, Victoria Central, and Eastern. The majority of patients agreed with the 24-hour urgent treatment centre at the our park site, 66.5% of respondents in fact, and also people valued the appointment option for dressing clinics rather than having to wait for a long period of time. Then when you look at the key considerations, as I said, the location of the community centres were based on public feedback, but also it's really crucial that we address issues of deprivation, which we do see quite prominently in certain areas within Wirral. We know the Wirral is 10 by 15 miles10 by 15 miles, but actually the difference in outcomes and the difference in deprivation versus wealth is quite considerable across Wirral, and so we had to take that into account when looking at where we would locate those sites for those patients and the timing of that. So you'll see that the Birkenhead Medical Centre, the proposal that was agreed was that would increase by 2 hours, that we would retain BCH, and that we would have access to extended hours GP and nurse appointments locally to facilitate our patients so that they wouldn't have to travel far, and as I said at the outset, that the urgent treatment centre at the Arrow Park site would only be used for those who have clinical needs for that. I think it's important to note that again, that not all of the football would be to the Arrow Park site, and I think that's something that's come back to us quite considerably over this period of time, was the transport issue and the issue around how do patients access Arrow Park. Actually, as I said here back in November, I'm hoping that all of our patients don't have to access Arrow Park Hospital. In fact, that's why we want to maintain a very robust, quality-driven service within our community. And that as transport falls outside of our commissioning function, we however are very mindful that that is an issue and would welcome a joint discussion with yourselves and a focused us on how we address that transport issue going forward. So being very mindful that it has been raised by a number of you on occasion, but actually this is about what's best for our patients. So the transport issue to the Arrow Park site, whilst it may be perceived as an issue, we would hope that the footfall would not increase to the Arrow Park site and that the delivery of services from Birkenhead BCH and the system would be robust and deliver a good quality care to our patients. The other issue which has raised some concerns in recent weeks since the decision was made at governing body was around Gladstone and Morton. So if we look at what's currently delivered from the Gladstone site, which was formerly in Parkfields, the centre is open 4 hours per day for 5 days a week, offering 75 appointments per week. I know that one of your colleagues have raised at the governing body issues around the timings of appointments, whether there was any fluctuation during the day, and we've looked at that again, and we see that there's approximately 13 to 15 appointments per day with no real variation in the time, so no peaks and no troughs, so quite a standard appointments through that time. What our proposal is to look at is to, instead of having those walk-in appointments, is the additional appointments of 82 GP extended access appointments, so offering actually in excess of what's currently being offered. But also when you look at the issues my patients attended the Gladstone Minor Injury Service, a lot of those ailments and a lot of those clinical conditions can be dealt with through pharmacy and through self-care. So what we are proposing is offering in excess of what's currently being delivered from the Gladstone site. And similarly for Morton. If you look at the provision at Morton, it's actually open longer hours, varying between 8 and 10 hours per day, 5 days a week, offering a total of approximately 90 patients per day, per week, sorry. And when you look at the, again, the fluctuations in timings during the day, we're not seeing a particular variation. It is quite standard across the day, looking at about 17 to 21 patients per day, but actually more so on the 17 appointments. What we're looking to offer in replacing that is extended hours appointments and dressing clinic appointments. Now, when you look at what's currently being offered of those 90 appointments that we're seeing, approximately 46% of those are for dressings. So what our proposal is to offer dressing appointments up to approximately 38 and 64 extended access appointments, which will give in excess of what's currently there. Currently, 90 patients are seen per week. What we're offering is 102 per week. But also, again, looking at some of the ailments, not only dressings, but also minor infections, sore throats, skin problems. We would want to encourage and to help to educate around the use of pharmacy and self-care in that. So in summary, looking at Gladstone and Morton, although the perception is that we're taking services away, what we're actually doing is offering in excess of what's currently being delivered from those two sites. So, in summary, we hope that you feel that we've been responsive to the needs and the feedback from our population. Public feedback has really helped us to inform our decision making, and that's been quite crucial throughout this whole process. I gave a guarantee here back in November that we would listen to our population, and I hope that that's been reflected in what we've come back to you with. In terms of how we will roll out the changes going forward, this will be a phased approach with a very, very strong communication and engagement exercise, and we'd like to invite people to be involved in that communication exercise as we go forward, particularly in the naming of the community sites, which can no longer be called the boarding centres. We'll be developing an implementation plan with timeframes, highlighting the phased approach to this. So really what we're here today is to detail what our proposal were, what was agreed on the 9th of July, and to take any questions and queries related to that.
Thank you very much, Councillor Sam. And just for the benefit of everybody, we've been joined today by Councillor Jo Bird. I think you're declaring for somebody who was a big loss. Right.
To appreciate how the extended hours will work. I have a leaflet, so this is probably the current leaflet. I'm not sure whether it's going to be revised or not. It tells me how tutoring up and how. The experience most people have, starting with their surgeries, is trying to get through there. The extended access services to book an appointment, speak to your GP receptionist during practice opening hours, so that's Cllr 1, or call 652 607 from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. on weekends. So if people are seeking extended access appointments, will we see a better way of actually getting their hands on them?
You're correct in that the extended access appointments can be accessed through their own practice, but also through 111 with the changes that are going to happen to 111. Those appointments can be accessed through that also. So if a patient rings 111 and their clinical need deems a GP appointment to be offered, that can be offered through the 111 service. I recognise that it's not always easy to gain access via the telephone through to GP practices, and that's something that we acknowledge. Probably right to not acknowledge that, but actually it is something that practices are certainly working on. I know that a lot of practices, and we've had feedback from practices about looking at how quickly an appointment, how quickly the telephone is answered, and the appointments that are offered, and they're continually monitoring and reviewing that. There's a piece of software now which helps practices to do that rather than just being through word of mouth, etc. So it is something that is certainly being looked at and being analysed. But I
do take on board the point that it's not always easy to get through on the time frames, depending on the time of day you're going. Can I just clarify, you talk about the additional payments that you're going to request. What can be paid off for the cluster? So is there going to be 82 appointments available? Or does it tell me where the appointments are? Where they're buying from. Does it explain, are they going to be available on the same day in the same way as it might be? Walk in there. So will they be available then? Will they be able to come back tomorrow? Or how's it going to work? And where are those appointments going to take place?
So the idea is that they will be same day appointments and they will be offered on the Parkfield practice site, which is where the minor energy service was previously located, which is.
Anybody else? Yes. Thanks, Chair. First of all, I'd like to say, you know, what a great job you did with the consultation and the feedback from that. And you've obviously taken real care about that feedback and placed it into what you've done now. So a great big take on your with that. I think it's good. You touched on part of what I see as the problem, and that is the to my fellow colleague, Councillor Gilchrist, which I see as the connection with your GP and appointments. My view on this was that we were supposed to be, in all these medical sectors, lessening the pressure on the National Health Service by having medical sectors to do a lot more and take a lot more of the weight. And this doesn't seem to be happening. I am a patient of the Bonds Medical Centre. And I don't see that, apart from the nurses that have been out there, I don't see a great deal of change in the medical sectors to be able to take that weight off the National Health Service. So whilst I welcome the clinics and I welcome the extra times and everything else that you've done, I think some care should be given to actually sorting out the other end with the doctors' medical centres so that people can get appointments, can get seen. And that will naturally take things like dressings, that can be done by a nurse in the medical centre rather than having to bother the National Health Service and them to take the weight on that. So I'd like to see a little bit more on that.
Thank you, and a really good question. And I think primary care has been really lucky in that the new contract that's come out for primary care is really transforming how it's being delivered, and exactly that. Is that there are things that only a GP can do, and there are things that different clinicians can do, and that part of that transformation is within the new contract. So there are new roles that my clinical colleague has explained the differences, but there's one called a physician associate, so we'll be getting more of them on the role as well. We'll be getting, within primary care, they'll be looking to have social prescribers, so they're people that will link. Sometimes people go to a GP and it isn't something a GP needs to deal with, it's something that somewhere else in the community can help them with. So there's that work going on, and that's alongside all of the work that we're doing in our neighbourhood, obviously, which is all about people, you know, looking after themselves, preventing ill health, preventing from ever needing to go to see a GP because they've developed a long-term condition. So again, you know, it's not just primary care, because I think this is a much broader aspect of how we transform services on Wirral as well.
Thank you, Chair. I've just got some concerns regarding peaks and troughs in medical help, you know, so the delivery of the service. If there was an outbreak or we have winter pressures and so forth, what plans have you got in place to deal with that?
So we'll continually monitor whatever services we put in place in terms of delivering urgent and primary care. But it's really important that at this time of year, whilst we're basking in the fabulous weather, that we start to consider our plans for winter time and consider the needs of our patients, particularly with those with chronic illnesses. So we have to start at this point in the time, this point in the year, and looking at what provision have we. Are we maximising and benefiting our patients in terms of flu vaccinations, pneumonia vaccinations, breast heat vaccines, if they've got COPD, managing their heart failure, managing those chronic diseases now, proactively, rather than in a reactionary way, so that by the time October, November, December comes and we're in flu season, that those patients will be well aware of how to manage their conditions, and that we do look at how we're doing things on a regular basis. And we look at the delivery of primary care, we look at delivery of urgent care across our whole system, not just within primary care in our community, but also within the hospital. And we look at how can we do it better and how can we improve care in terms of making sure that we're proactively managing, so not closing the door when doors, both actually looking at how can we do it ahead of time so that patients and ourselves are well aware of what's coming. So,
thank you. I've got Councillor Callan and I've got Councillor Barry and Councillor Jordan. Is anybody else? But
no, I was just going to come back to Councillor Rowland, but I can do that after.
But take these three, I don't mind.
Thank you very much. It was a clarification around the children's aspect of the urgent treatment centre for a start, because we didn't quite sort of get what was going to happen with that. Also, you said it's all age for the remaining walking centres. Obviously, that doesn't include older ones. I'm assuming we're carrying on with that as it is now. And obviously, the provision for children's only stops at a certain time. Is it 10? I think it is at the moment. I can't remember. So I was just wondering how the urgent care treatment centres are going to fall into that, what we're going to be able to provide for walking centres, and how does that fit into our children's services? Thank you.
So for children, all age can be seen at the urgent treatment centre, and which is why the 24-hour urgent treatment centre gives a much more consistent approach to how we deliver care.
Specialised, and obviously separate from the same body, but to use a sort of separate area for children within the urgent treatment centre. So.
Oh yes, of course, all of those area issues will be taken into account, so that there will be absolutely no problem with safeguarding and no issue raised around that.
Thanks for that.
Thank you, Jo. Thanks for the presentation. You said earlier on that this was actually voted through on the CCG early in July. Was it the 6th of the 9th of July? Is there a go-live date for the only operating this system at present? And also, once we are live and running, will there be a review period where we can come back and look at it? I'm particularly concerned about the Morton area and the Gladstone, which seems to be the most affected areas. So the review and are we actually live at present?
Thank you. So the earliest we'd be looking to implement these changes will be from April next year. So we'll be working at those changes, and there's a contract time that we'd have to give notice. But you know, so that's all something that will happen from April. We are always, part of why we've done these changes is that we want to improve on our constitutional standards. And as part of our work, we have to be assured that performance of our providers is as the needs, meets the needs of the population. So we always have to review everything. So and absolutely this would be key to that as well. You know, on Wirral, we are really lucky that our, and I appreciate people say it's difficult to get hold of our GP practices at times. However, the patient feedback, the experience for our GP practices, we're amongst the best in England. And I think, you know, that is another way that we continually monitor and the impact on the needs of our patients as well on the population.
Thank you. My question is around the GP extended access. And while I fully appreciate that not everybody needs to see a GP, I think the population out there need educating in what members of the MDT actually do and how much qualified they are to actually carry out those roles. There's been a whole range of new professions come into the NHS lately, but most people don't appreciate roles like physician's associates.
Yeah.
And I think they're getting a diluted service and the GP's not interested. So I think tell them what these people do and how well qualified they are, and also the triage system. Can you tell me a little bit about how that would work so I know how people are going to be signposted to the level?
Absolutely, I think there's part of the comms, because it is so confusing, isn't it, to think all of us and now the families of us that don't live in the NHS as we do, trying to explain what I think all these different roles are. So it would be a very key aspect. I'm very glad to work with the council to make sure that our comms is pitched in a way that people will understand what we're explaining these different roles. The triage is very much something in each GP practice that they'll be asked to do, and it's something to make sure that people will be, you know, signposted to the right person, because we do need to make sure that our model going forward is sustainable clinically as well, and we don't want a GP to be seeing somebody or a physician associate or a nurse or a nurse assistant. Actually, it needs to be somebody else, because that's, you know, a waste of everybody's time, isn't it? So, absolutely, that would be key.
Councillor Muspratt
and then Councillor Nolan. Yeah, I wanted to ask you about transport. You said you're coming back to it, but I'm conscious that you're going. So, are you coming back on the question now?
The question now.
Right, given the changes in the mind model, stagecoach. Have you taken those into consideration? Because it's going to have a tremendous effect on who can go where.
As I said, we fully recognise that transport for our patients is a significant issue. We have varying degrees of deprivation and varying degrees of socioeconomic issues in Europe, and not everybody has a car. And I recognise that as you do. As I said, transport is outside of our commissioning function, but having said that, we want to work with you on how we can improve for our population and how we can ensure that those patients who need transport or need the Arrow Park site will have that facility, and we want to work with you on that. But I go back to the premise that the urgent treatment centre is for specific clinical needs, and actually we don't foresee a huge increase in footfall to the Arrow Park site. The reason that we want to maintain services, urgent care services within our community, is because of the feedback that we got. It's because of the fact that patients are trusting of the services which are delivered within the community, particularly the three areas which we mentioned, Birkenhead, Wallasey, and the Eastern services. And so in order to ensure that those the patients' needs are met, we want to keep delivery of care as close to home as possible. And as time goes on, we're looking more at how we can look at patients and deliver care close to the home. You'll hear at times the concept of left shift, where patients are coming out of the hospital, we're coming away from a delivery model which is centred around secondary care. And we're looking at how can we do that better in our community, and how can we deliver services closer to home. Place-to-face care and population health are very much to the fore at the moment. So it's about how we can deliver care close to home, recognising that some of our population will need to go to the Arrow Park site, and how we can work with you and councillors on that transport.
to be certain from certain very early, will have a very, very reduced service. And I want to make taken that into consideration for at least two services definitely going.
Thank you, and thank you for raising transport, because it's an issue for us, and it's not just about urgent care, as I said in our governing body. This impacts on planned care as well, so we don't commission transport services, so when these decisions are made, it's not always with our input or any involvement in health and the impact it will have on our health services and our plans going forward. So we would welcome a discussion with the council and with ASK about how we can look at this going forward.
So you did take part in the consultation as you travel put out, many people in this room filled in. You took part in that, did you?
I'm not sure if we did it,
but that's the only way that you could. We have no jurisdiction.
I think Councillor has made the point that there are real problems arising for people who want to access Arrowpark Hospital in general because of the reduction of the services recently, the 118 on a Sunday, and now the 418 and the 42B.
We are have referring to the bus services from the UFO.
It's the 41A, 44.
41 and the 2.
Yeah, okay.
The 2's gone as well, so they've got three services that they haven't got to get to Eastman.
I think we've all highlighted the fact that we are concerned about transport. We need to use every method we can to put pressure on those people who provide the transport to understand that people need to get to these services. And I know the transport group hasn't met recently, as I said, we think it has met recently, but there is a piece of work to be done there by that group of elected members.
Chair, can I just make a point that if a body like the CCG was to make a representation when the consultations were out, it would have a lot more weight than a lot of other people, and I'm very surprised if you haven't done that.
I agree with that, and I'm sure that we can find out, and the council know, as you know, whether or not representation was made during the consultation review, which is now finished, I have to say, although there's still a certain amount of activity going on around the risks and the bus provision. Councillor Nolan.
Do you want to add to that?
Yes, but it's definitely something that we're all very cognizant of.
Can I just come back on the transport issue? We're not just trying to get to our own farm. If I phone the high schools at home, I can't even get to my own farm for surgery because there is no bus.
I take that point as well, but we're not examining all services in general.
I know that, but it's
okay.
It's a problem.
Can I say thank you very much? I know you must go, Dr.
Can I come back on the transport issue? I recognise that for every one of you, the transport for our patients to the services, not only at the Arrow Park site, but also their local GP service or their local community hub, like Easton or BCH, Broken Hill Medical Centre, is an issue. And as Nesta said, and I've said already, we don't commission, but that doesn't take away our responsibility to those whom we serve, those whom we commission services for in terms of healthcare. And so we would be more than happy to look, go back and look and see whether we were involved in that consultation. I'm not sure whether we were, and I can't answer that for you today. But also to work with you on how we can move forward, because the delivery of services from a particular venue are only as good as those patients who can use it. And so we have to be mindful of that and work with you on how we take that forward. And the final thing is coming back to Councillor Rowlands and also Councillor Jordan around what is delivered within medical centres, what is delivered within surgeries. The delivery of health of general practice is based on a model from the 1940s. It has evolved considerably over that time, but there's still somewhere a feeling that only the GP can help the patient. And I recognise my own humility in terms of I'm probably not as good as a social prescriber in terms of dealing with social issues that patients have, but I'm not as good as a nurse at doing these things. I freely hold my hands up and say that. But it's how we can use the services of our allied healthcare professionals, but encourage our patients to have trust in that in the same way as the consultation has recognised that they have trust in the services that are already delivered. And so it is an evolutionary process. I think that we have come a long way, because when I started as a GP 16 years ago, advanced nurse practitioners using the pharmacist from either ailments and using a physician's associate was something. something that was unheard of. So we have come a long way, we have evolved. What we could do is feed up a little bit on that. And anything that you can do to help us in terms of our communication engagement around utilising all of our allied healthcare professionals would be greatly welcome.
Thank you very much. If you want to go, I can wait for that. We'll move on now to the next person who. The people who we're going to hear from now are people who came when the last consultation exercise was on and gave us their views about what those proposals were and what the impact of the site would be. So the rationale is that we've got the same people back to reflect on what's been agreed this time and see what they feel about that. So the next person is Dr. Mark Fraser, who's from the Primary Care Rural GP Federation. Dr. Fraser, are you here? Yes.
Good evening, everybody. So my name is Mark Fraser. I did speak last time. Thank you for the invite to come back. I think, first of all, I'd like to start by paying tribute to the CCG for what's been a very comprehensive and I think challenging is probably not an adequate word to describe the process that they've gone through, but I think that they deserve a lot of credit for having been brave enough to do it and for being able to listen to the feedback that they've been given. I think it's a very difficult task that they've been given. Redesigning services in the health service never is an easy thing to do. However, I think that it is an essential thing to do moving forward for the reasons that we heard many times last time. I think the offer that has been made, I think satisfies most of the boxes to redesign a service that allows for new services and improved services whilst also consolidating existing services and not making too draconian changes to the things that people obviously hold very dear to them. I think that from Primary Care Rural's perspective, we are very strong advocates of general practice, being a representative body of general practitioners, but we believe that quality access to health care in a local area is the most important thing that we can achieve. And we would like to think that we are very, very, very confident to deliver that. With that, there is a requirement for some degree of equity for the offer across all areas. There shouldn't be an unfair distribution of services. And there should be a degree of consistency to what services can be expected across our area as well. But that is difficult to achieve given the variation that we have in such a small area in our populations, which lead to very different needs and requirements for local populations, and also very different estate facilities, practitioners working in the different areas. So it is quite difficult. I think that at the last time we spoke, there was a clear need to understand that the urgent primary care, urgent care services have a big impact on emergency services. Emergency services being really the A&E at Harrow Park. If we can get urgent primary care working very well, then hopefully that reduces massively the impact upon emergency services, which are critical to all of us at our hours of most desperate need. I think we also are aware that we are not alone in this, and that our communities play a big factor in being able to deliver all this, and hopefully we will continue to work with our communities, with our patients, with other groups. And that has been highlighted by the effects of transport, but there's also the effects of housing, effects of schooling, opportunities, work opportunities or lack of them. All of those things play factors in what determines the health of our populations and the requirements of them and the likelihood of them to need urgent or even emergency care. So in summary, I'd like to say that Primary Care Rural is happy to support proposals as made. We think they represent the best opportunity to delivering a new and improved urgent care service on the road. The urgent treatment centre, we would like to think, should be GP-led, if not certainly primary care-led, and that gives the best opportunity, we think, for patients to be given access to the highest quality possible within the parameters of what we're doing.
Thank you, Dr. Fraser. Anybody want to ask a question? Dr.
extended access distribution for 2018-19.
And
it gives a list of the practices taking part and the total, overall total of 38,654 appointments. So when this was drawn up, did all practice in the world, how did this get drawn up? How did the practices bid into this? If we were not from West Wirral, so looking at St George's, Heswell and Pensby, Greenley, TG Medical Centre, none of which I've figured out its own. Now, a huge show is given for our park extended access because that's seen as the service in the community location. The issue in the West Wirral was question of how many practices are there, but there was also distribution based on need and deprivation. A formula was used to try and work out where these should go. So, having any comments on the formula? Are there views about the formula being kept under review to see if it's appropriate in future years and so on?
Okay, so it was a long and drawn out and complicated process, of which there are many factors that led to that list that you have in front of you. There are two GP federations on the Wirral, and the ask from the commissioners was that a population-based percentage be delivered by each federation. So that a pro rata division, if you like. So that was the first division that happened. Then both federations delivered in slightly different ways and slightly different parameters and slightly different priorities. And I think what you've got to remember is that general practice is already under a massive amount of pressure, and these represent a huge additional amount of work to be done. So there is only so many times you can go back to the well and ask for another four appointments out of the GP, another 4 hours work out of the GP, before it becomes counterproductive and that you actually lose GPs because it becomes too onerous. So from my federation's perspective, we asked our members, as the numbers increased over, it's been a 3-year programme, and each year has been a complete review and start again. That will happen again in April 1st, 2020. The whole service will be reviewed again. We asked our member practices how much they could deliver. These appointments have to be delivered between 6:30 and 8 in the evening and up on Saturday and Sunday. Now, most practices aren't open on Sunday, certainly, and not many were open on Saturday at all. So it's new for them working and being open on Saturday. And I think you can see now. I think at the last count there was something like 20 practices open on Saturday mornings offering appointments. We've looked at the usage of those appointments and the several factors playing to how they are utilised, one of which is when they become available. So originally they were mostly supposed to be available in advance. That leads to the two things really. One is that it doesn't really help the demand on the day, and also when you make an appointment in what might be a different practice to your usual practice, or maybe at a weekend, ahead of time, sometimes things change and your desire to fulfill that appointment may not be as high as it was when you made it,